This is episode 73 of the Women in Depth podcast. The information found in this podcast is not a substitute for help from a licensed mental health professional. Hi, and welcome back to the podcast. I'm your host, Dr. Lourdes Fiotto. Today's episode was inspired by a response to a previous episode with Dr. Sharon Cohen, and this was episode 54, When Successful Women Fail at Relationships. And this listener was wanting to know more about what women can do to attract and experience the love relationships that they desire. And her question really had to do with, is it really me and the work I need to do within myself, the blocks that I can uncover, or does it have to do with what's outside of me, the world and the men around me? And she really wanted to know how all women, not just women who are professional or earning large salaries, she wanted information that all women could use in understanding how to create the love relationships that they desire. So in today's episode, Dalila Jusic-LaBerge, a licensed marriage and family therapist with a private practice in Agoura Hills, California, is going to deepen our understanding of how to create the love relationships that they desire. Dalila Jusic-LaBerge, owner of Be Here and Now Counseling, specializes in working with accomplished women who yearn for love but feel lost in romantic relationships. Dalila helps them reduce anxiety, stress, and heal from trauma. Thus, women are more able to connect to their own emotions, develop their intuition, and be ready to connect on a deeper emotional level with their loved ones and with themselves. Hi, Dalila, and welcome to the podcast.
Hi, Lourdes. Thank you very much for having me.
I'm excited to talk about our topic today, which has to do with women and women who are yearning for healthy relationship. And I just know that this is something that so many women struggle with at different times and in different ways. So thank you for being here today to share your expertise.
Oh, thank you so much. It's my pleasure. Absolutely.
Before we jump into today's topic, Dalila, could you share a little bit more about how you got drawn into this area of focus in your work with women?
Well, it's basically started with my personal quest. I always had this idea of pure love, and it was always so important in my personal life. And then as I went along in life and in my professional development, I noticed that this is basically one of the most essential quests in human life. That's my personal philosophical conclusion. But I noticed also that this topic of love has been kind of trivialized by media. And we have to talk basically about love in general. Although our topic is romantic love, they're all tied in together because these are all important aspects of success in romantic love. We are talking about universal love, self-love, and they all need to be addressed.
You know, I'm so glad that you shared this because I see this too, where it doesn't really matter what a person has achieved and the other aspects of their life that, you know, people will look at and say, wow, they're successful or they've gotten somewhere. Everyone yearns for that connection, you know, for that relationship.
Exactly.
Yeah. And I also love how you are touching on different types of love. Although like today, our focus is romantic love because there are many different kinds of love. And I'm not sure which episode it was, but it was with Tamara Powell. And we talked about how in the English language, there's only one word for love. It's love.
Uh-huh.
Okay. And that, for example, in the Greek language, they have so many words to describe all these different nuances of love. And it's interesting that, you know, here in America, in the Western world, we just have love. And you're right. There is universal love. There is brotherly love. There is soul love. There's so many types of love.
Exactly. Right. And we get so many confusing messages about love in general, but more importantly, about romantic love in today's society, as women especially.
Yeah, isn't that interesting how
something that we yearn for can be so complex.
Right? It's so complex and yet so simple. We are wired for this. We are mammals. And, you know, we have this attachment that we develop as a baby with our caregiver, mother or father, whoever feeds us and makes us safe.
Yeah.
And yet it's kind of trivialized. And almost sometimes I feel people who yearn for this are kind of almost put in a category of a less powerful people. I don't know how to express this, but it's a little bit in some ways deemed as not as important as some other aspects in life.
Mm-hmm. I think so. And then many people make that choice for themselves and put other things ahead of it.
Right.
You know, and then there's a cost later. There's a sacrifice.
Definitely.
For whether you consciously or unconsciously decide that this is not that important and other things are more important, I think it comes back to you.
Definitely.
And so today, Dalila, you and I actually talked already about having you come onto the podcast. And then I had received a response or some feedback from a listener who had been listening to an episode with Dr. Sharon Cohen. Actually, it was episode 54 on when successful women fail at relationships. Mm-hmm. And I'm just going to read what this listener wrote in.
Sure.
So this is what she said. She said, "Listening to this as a single parent in between jobs and identifying even so, I bore 100% of the parenting responsibilities, which made having a career challenging. In a different universe, I could have applied my perfectionist streak to a career, but I have applied it to a secure environment conducive to growth. Despite having a strong sense of myself, it feels that nobody I wants me back. Mm. In 10 years, I have had nearlys, almost, not quites. I still have hope, though. I'd love to believe that it's as simple as just identifying what is blocking you. I'd love to believe that the problem is me, because that I can change. If the problem is the world and the men around me, then I am powerless." So Dalila, what are your thoughts just initially hearing these words from this listener, which is actually the catalyst for this episode that we're having?
Right. Well, it is so profound and deep, her message, and I'm so inspired by how this lady is still hopeful and still there is some pain in this message and not knowing where to go and what to ascribe this struggle to. Is it me or is it the world or men?
Yeah.
So there is so much actually to talk about.
I know.
Where should we start? Well,
yeah.
I would like to start with saying I want to acknowledge, yes, it is actually difficult in today's world, especially for educated women. So I would like to touch upon statistics for college-educated women. It's very difficult out there in the dating scene because there are fewer college-educated men than college-educated women on the dating scene. So I spoke with a gentleman, he's a journalist, and he wrote a book, John Berger, Datanomics, How Dating Became a Lopsided Number Game. And he gives statistics about how in big cities such as New York, especially in the East Coast, New York, Washington, and other cities, there is more college-educated women than men. So men have many more choices than women do. So men's behavior changes. There is a lot of research that he quotes in his book. I don't want to go into these statistics specifically because I don't want people to be stuck on it, because there is a lot of this internal work that this lady brought up. And what I say in this case is, you know, there is just you and whatever you believe in, whether it's God or universe, and that man at the end somewhere who is going to be thrilled to be with you specifically. So you just kind of need to see that, not in terms of statistics, but in terms of your own personal quest.
So Dalila, really, it's not as simple, like you said, of, you know, who is it? Is it the external world? Is it me? Because I think that regardless of what the answer is to that question, the one aspect you have some control over is yourself.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. And that's something that we can focus on, and meanwhile,
right.
enjoy that process instead of focusing on, oh my God, when will this happen? You know, I give some advice on how to actually enjoy this dating game. We can talk about this a little bit later, but just to kind of finish this conversation about these statistics, I think, and John Berger also suggests that we can expand our dating pool. In other words, maybe we can go and date men that are not, that don't have college education, that don't have these letters behind their name, because that's not a guarantee that two of you will be a good match anyway, emotionally and intellectually. I've met many highly educated men that we couldn't even get along, not get along, but we didn't even have this intellectual connection. I think the way that my brain is designed and the way I think is different than some of those college educated men, while some men that don't have those letters behind their name, they may be also well read, and they may be just people who decided not to go and pursue regular education. Think of this show, Sex in the City. There are a couple of men that I think could be great men, even though they don't have formal education. Have you seen this show, Lourdes?
It's been a long time and I didn't watch the whole thing, but I know enough.
Right.
I saw enough of it.
So the main character, Carrie, I believe was her name. She had this Mr. Big, who is this prototype of what majority women are after. And then there was this other guy that she was dating for a long time. He was a carpenter or something, but I didn't see any lacking in potential for emotional or intellectual connection with him, even though she's a writer. And it didn't work out with Aiden. Yes, his name was Aiden. But my point is that by being more open to more men that are not necessarily college educated, that can help overall picture, overall statistics. But they may be surprised, they may realize that some of these men are great men and they may find the love of their life. Ultimately, they don't need to marry anybody that they don't feel connected with. And that's going to be up to them. But just being open-minded, that's all that I'm suggesting in this regard.
So it's this idea that women, because they have their standards or their expectations or their ideas of what they are looking for in a man, perhaps expanding it to widen the pool of possibilities is what you're saying.
Exactly. Because this comes in play when we are looking into these superficial characteristics. And you see many people that get married, you know, we kind of have this agenda. Yes, I'm going to finish college and I'm going to marry this wonderful guy. And two of us look like this perfect couple. We have a similar education level. We come from good family. He's good looking. I'm good looking. We kind of all try to find the best people we can find in terms of these characteristics. It's like mate selection. But often, you know, it can happen that these people fall apart because they chose mates based on these superficial characteristics. And when people start doing this internal work, you know, when the children grow up, they figure that they don't have much in common. And that can happen that their marriage falls apart. Everybody wonders what was wrong. They looked so happy. They looked so beautiful together. So my point is just kind of being more in touch with who you are and making choices based on that rather than these superficial characteristics.
So sometimes for women, what can happen is wanting a certain type of man, like, for example, like you said, the prototype in Sex in the City with Mr. Big. And maybe this man is, you know, he's college educated, he's successful, he's financially stable, all the things that these can become superficial qualities that you're looking at.
Right.
Right. Okay. I'm going to play devil's advocate Dalila. Okay.
Sure.
Bring yes, it on. because I want, I'm thinking of, you know, what are some of the questions that maybe audience members are thinking? Mm-hmm. So what about, you know, if there's a woman who's thinking, so you're asking me to lower my standards, you know, is there, what's wrong with wanting a man who is, you know, fill in the blank, college educated, financially stable, and then you can just go down the whole checklist, never been married before, no children, you know, all those things.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm not saying that you should lower your standard by any means. I'm just saying that in a dating game, as you date people, it can be helpful if you're more open-minded and saying, let's see what he has to bring on. I'm not saying that you should go and marry somebody that you're not attracted to.
Yeah.
You ultimately need to be attracted and have enough respect for him for this relationship to be successful. But you may be surprised that some of these characteristics, you know, may be not that important.
Yeah. That makes so much sense. And it's really about kind of looking at how we get stuck and limit ourselves because we think it has to be a certain way.
Right.
So, Dalila, I'm going to kind of take a few steps backwards right here. And I want to kind of go back to the to why this is so important, you know, because it is something that I, you know, see so many people struggle with, and you don't even have to be in therapy for this to be something that's a concern for you. But why do you think this area matters so much to people? The idea of romantic love, of a long-term relationship, marriage, commitment?
I feel that this is a quest that everybody has. We are all born to have this connection. And as I already said, we are wired to attach. We are mammals. We have this part of brain that is capable of this love. And that's our ultimate desire to achieve this. But there is a lot of things that we need to be aware of as we are going into this, especially for women. You know, one of these that can somewhat hinder or help us is our family of origin. In other words, that's attachment, where we come from. What kind of attachment did we have? And even if we had the best family, we can have some kind of trauma that our family of origin can carry so much, you know, from a long time ago, from even our ancestors. There is, like, for instance, each family has their own story. Like women in that particular family, they have their own story about relationship with men. What are your thoughts about men? Like,
yeah,
all men are the same. You know those, like, statements.
Mm-hmm.
All men are just after one thing.
Yeah.
You know, I don't even want to add more.
Right.
They can be even offensive to men. But we carry this from generation to generation, and how we as women in our family think we are valued, and, you know, who we are and how men treat us in general. And how did your mom go through this relationship with your dad, or, you know, even further down?
Because really, really the patterns for relating are what we learn from our environment when we are young.
Exactly.
And the messages that we internalized about what we saw around us and what that meant.
Definitely. But even more than family of origin, we our cultural values as women, we get these messages about how we need to behave in romantic relationships. So we get these confusing messages all the time. For instance, we are raised culturally for centuries that we need to be these passive recipients. And this takes away our sense of empowerment as women. In other words, we are supposed to be waiting for a man to make the first move. You know the story of a sleeping
beauty,
yeah, in a tower.
And, yeah.
But this is not going to happen. Yeah. All right. So besides cultural and family influence, from this comes our sense of identity. We carry this through generations. So we place a lot of value on being beautiful, being chosen by somebody. We are expected to be young, beautiful, slim, and to have a certain demeanor, as I already described, on how we need to behave. So we are not supposed to be assertive, like, even, you know, you know how in workplace assertive women versus assertive men are viewed.
Yeah, that's very fascinating. Just from the family of origin to cultural values to the sense of identity, there's so many layers. No wonder this gets complicated, you know?
Right.
Well, I think too, you know, one of the things also that came to mind as you were writing this is I see this with women who are in their, who are in college, also in their 30s right now, where they've kind of grown up at a time where highly sexualized behavior is normalized and sometimes given some type of positive reinforcement. And so there's a lot of confusion on how to behave sexually, mm-hmm. which I think is a big challenge right now for women mm-hmm. who are trying to connect, but yet confused about, you know, am I supposed to be sexual in order to be loved? You know, that type of message is also very confusing.
Definitely. And that goes back to these messages from the society. And this is one type of message, but then on the other hand, we get this other type of message. You know?
Yeah.
We get all these confusing messages that are contradictory to each other, yeah. as a matter of fact. And as women, we are naturally wired to actually be kind of attuned to how to please others, and we are raised like that as well. And that can be another issue for us in all this story, because we try to fit to a certain mold, and that doesn't lead us to much success, because then our, should I say, message to the world becomes watered down.
Right. So, Dalila, can you share what some of the myths or misperceptions or fears are regarding this romantic love and finding this relationship?
Definitely. Well, one of the big ones is that only so-called beautiful, young, so-called hot women can find love. So, as I already want to say, that this definitely depends on the level of your growth and where you are with your self-confidence and what it is that you're looking for. So if you're interested in men that are only after these superficial qualities, no matter how so-called beautiful or hot you are, there will always be somebody who is going to be younger, smarter, prettier than you. But I want to say that there are definitely men who are looking for true emotional connection with a partner. And I actually really don't like to talk about women in this way. The biggest thing is that we are very complex and beautiful beings, but unfortunately, we don't know it inside. We may actually know it intellectually. We may observe, and people can tell us this, and we compare ourselves and figure out, yes, I'm beautiful. I had success in dating. I have success in school, in career. But somehow we always feel that we are lacking in some ways. We always compare ourselves to some ideal that we don't feel like we don't measure up to. And that kind of makes me sad. That's another reason why I embarked on this task to help women with romantic love, which ties in to so many other aspects such as anxiety and self-esteem and stuff like that. So this mindset for striving for more comes from our family, as I already mentioned. Our parents really want the best for us, and they prompt us to always do better in school. If you get 98 on a test, I don't know, I'm sure, you know, oh, what happened with those 2 points?
Yeah.
I mean, that's how I was raised, and I believe many people have.
Which actually sends like that message that, you know, you're not enough, you know, because,
exactly.
Right? Yeah.
So this definitely leads to our anxiety, depression, and struggle to be able to actually feel happy. They didn't teach us how to be happy. They taught us how to be a good girl.
Right. Yeah.
How to please, how to read other people and kind of modify our behavior to that.
So how to be what the world wants us to be, what the world says is good, okay, beautiful, acceptable, enough.
Right. And there are so many messages, as we mentioned. You have to be demure, or you have to be this sex goddess, but then you have to be the best mother to your children, like, you know.
You know, it's really amazing that, you know, that women can feel any sense of confidence or knowledge of who they are with having to wade through all of this, you know?
Right.
Yeah. And I think that, you know, for our listener who wrote in, you know, her experience is something that so many women, you know, share because of everything that you're describing, all of these layers of expectations and confusing messages that, you know, women have to first become aware of, then find a way to navigate through.
Definitely.
Yeah.
And then another one is that men are intimidated by smart women. Another like false statement. And actually, there are some men that may be intimidated, but intelligent men actually enjoy connecting with you on an intellectual level. The problem for intellectual women is that they sometimes have struggle connecting with men emotionally. And the reason is that we may have neglected ourselves and our needs, and we may not be in touch with our emotions. Just as we already discussed a little bit, we kind of look at others and how we need to please others rather than knowing what we are and who we are and what our needs are.
I see that a lot, Dalila, where, you know, for my female clients and my male clients, where the woman is connecting with this man intellectually, and she perceives that that intellectual connection is actually an emotional connection and doesn't realize that she is all in her head with everything, the overanalyzing and thinking things over. And and then I've actually had men who shared with me that they thoroughly admire a certain woman or attracted to her because she is so bright, so intelligent, but she is not able to see him or connect with him on an emotional level.
That's true. And that's the problem, because we are so raised, actually whole society is raised to be intellectual and analytical and to achieve all of these amazing goals. And you know, we women have so much education, but we neglected that ourselves. And another reason why we may be in our heads is due to some kind of trauma and struggle that we had. And that's why it's safer to be in our heads. And that's why many women who are very high functioning women, who do so well intellectually and in their careers and have these wonderful lives, they may be struggling with anxiety and depression, even though they don't have symptoms of not functioning in their work and as mothers and wives, but inside they may be feeling so frustrated, angry, and not even understanding why.
Yeah. So are there any other myths, Dalila, that you want to share as far as what are some of the things that get in the way of this for women?
Well, another one that I hear is good things come to those who wait. you know, oh, this will happen one day while I'm doing all these things in my career and focusing on conquering the world and going to Africa and save children. None of this means that I'm saying you shouldn't do this. I that's wonderful. I really applaud. Or who am I to even applaud women? I mean, it's very inspiring to see that they lead their beautiful lives regardless of this aspect in their life. But, you know, if you are focusing on all these things and not focusing on this aspect of your life, it's not gonna happen. So what I encourage women is to, you know, go ahead and go on that quest, and you got to own your life and go and get that man. I don't mean by this go after that one particular man, but what I actually suggest is that you take some charge and not to be in that mindset of, oh, Am I good enough for him? Did I text him too much? Did I not text enough? You know, with going and overanalyzing your behavior. Keep enjoying your life and doing your wonderful things in life and be open. Give him a chance to show it to you. And in the worst case scenario, you're going to go on a few dates, enjoy a few conversations, and maybe make a good friend with a man who isn't necessarily the right fit. Maybe he will introduce you to some of his friends that you may be a wonderful fit with.
So really part of this too is, you know, one of the things that you've talked about or written about, Dalila, is that women get in their own way because they're afraid to be themselves. And I think that comes up with like what you were saying with, you know, should I be this way? Should I not be this way? Did I text too much? Did I text too little? And they're trying to be what they think is the right fit for the person instead of just being themselves.
Exactly. That's one of the big issues, because in order to find that right man, another one of these myths is that all good men are taken. What does it mean to be a good man? It has to be right for you. In order to find that right man, you need to be yourself so that he can see that beauty that all other world sees, except for us. Because we are so focused on what we are lacking. And therefore, we try to be this vanilla. Not that something is wrong with vanilla, actually. I like vanilla. You know, something that blends, basically.
Yeah.
So be yourself, be your vanilla, be cinnamon or cayenne, you know, whatever it is you. And there will be a man who will be inspired by that.
Yeah, because I always, you know, for me, one of the things that when I'm working with women in this situation, it's, you know, if you never show him who you are, what ends up happening is over time, if it turns into a relationship and then you suddenly start really expressing how you feel and asking for what you need. A lot of times in a relationship, this is where there are problems because you kept this part of you hidden for so long.
That's a great point, yes.
You know, and so, you know, you kept these, you know, these spicier parts of yourself hidden, these flavorful parts, because you didn't want to push him away or you wanted to attract. And yet these are what make you uniquely beautiful. And if a person can never get in to see these things, they can never really love you for who you are.
That's so well said, Lourdes. Thank you so much. But more than that, I also want to kind of encourage women to be able to say what they want in terms of dating. Specifically, like I see that many women are kind of coy and they don't want to say, oh, I want the love of my life, you know?
Right.
They don't want to claim that. They go and say, oh, I don't know, I'm kind of like just whatever, you know? So how do you mean to attract men who really want long-term relationship if you don't claim that?
Right.
When you say, I want marriage and a man, you know, who will love me forever, that doesn't mean you're saying that to that particular guy. You're just telling him, can you measure up to this? Can you show to me that you can be the one?
Right.
Let's see, you know. And men love challenge. That's very attractive to men. They love challenge. And you can allow them then to show you these wonderful things that they can do to show that they can be the one. And if he's not the one, then again, you maybe had a good dinner or coffee, whatever your date was, and you met another person.
Yeah. I think, you know, one of the things that Dr. Cohen talked about in her episode is that something that women, we can tend to do is that we take our dates so seriously, like, you know, oh my gosh, is this the one? And we put all this pressure on this coffee date or this dinner date, when really, she said, it's about practice. You're going on this date to practice your communication skills, to practice connecting with someone. And just see it as that instead of thinking, is this the one, you know?
Exactly. Yeah, that's something along the lines that I say, just go out and I'm going to meet a person. It's like not necessarily a day. I'm going to meet somebody,
yeah,
you know, mm-hmm. to meet a man and see, you know, have a conversation.
Just be curious and open to what happens in that encounter.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And another thing that kind of goes along with these issues for women is that we overfunction, that kind of builds up on our conversation about how we try to please other people and try to follow every advice. And, you know, that advice isn't necessarily bad, but if we don't have it in us, if that advice doesn't fit with us, it will just be strange. You know, you will feel like further, like you will feel discouraged and it will come across as wrong or fake. So, but in order to be able to have that inside, you have to be in touch with your own emotions and be able to express that. What's important to mention here in terms of overfunctioning is that one thing that men are like is that they love to please you. If you are talking about good men that hopefully our audience wants to attract and wants to have a relationship with, they love to please women. They love to give. So if you are overfunctioning and constantly analyzing yourself and hiding away what your needs are and wishes and desires, you don't give him a chance. You don't give him, you don't allow him that empowerment to feel that he's able to give you something, that he's able to please you. So many men feel disconnected with women like because of this particular reason.
So can this also show up, Dalila, with, you know, women who perceive themselves and who want to be very independent and strong, and they have this thing that I don't need a man? You know, that's kind of a one of the messages that they carry, which is, you know, I know they're coming from a place of, you know, empowerment and strength, but that can also work against them.
That's exactly true, because they kind of, you mentioned these messages that we get, you know, men love independent women, but men also, the fact that you say, oh, I love, you know, I don't know, something trivial, chocolate ice cream. Let's take a trivial example. Mm-hmm. And then if he buys you chocolate ice cream when he visits you, that's his way of trying to please you and show that he listens. And it's a beautiful small thing, but it's so, you know, that doesn't mean that you're not independent. If you allow somebody else to please you, doesn't mean that you are basket case who is clingy.
Right. So it's really interesting, just all of these different layers of, you know, expectations and messages and needs and wants, and it's a lot to wade through. So Dalila, for women who are listening, what would be some suggestions that you feel they can take to become more successful in dating and attracting that right relationship?
What would be suggestions? So what I suggest, besides everything that we talked about, is it all actually depends on what the agenda is. So I'm talking about the desire to find a long-term committed relationship or finding love. So what matters in this case is to address these underlying issues that we talked about. There is a lot of attachment and emotional wounding and trauma that can cause the difficulty in finding the right partner and being attracted to the right man. So these kinds of issues are followed by adult anxiety. They usually show up like adult anxiety, and that prevents us from living a full and joyful life and from being authentic. And being authentic in dating game is your best bet. But, you know, we can't just switch on and off if we are struggling with our anxiety. Another thing is that comes lacking due to this anxiety is confidence. So living in our heads, you know, is the reason why we can't relax and be authentic and be confident. And this just can wear us down. So addressing these issues would be important. But in day-to-day life, regardless whether you started addressing these issues or you are already okay with that, I suggest enjoy the ride, go and meet the people, be yourself, let them show you what they've got. Don't go, you know, you're the one who has a job opening and you're the interviewer and see if they fit the job description, the most important job, the most important opening in your life.
So, Dalila, what is the best way for our audience members to learn more about your work and to get in touch with you?
So, they can visit my website, beherenow.com, call me, 310-889-4958. They can call me to see if I'm the right match for helping them work through these underlying issues. Or they can also email me, djl@beherenow.com.
And we will be sure to put all of those links and that information in the show notes. And is there anything that you'd like to share with the audience as far as any, you know, services or products that might be helpful to them?
Well, I offer online therapy and I'm licensed in California. I utilize sensory motor psychotherapy. And this is a very powerful modality that allows me to address potential trauma that prevents our clients from being able to be in touch with their emotions, intuition, and from being authentic. And this is what usually causes women to be in their heads. And again, that trauma doesn't only mean some horrific events that might have happened. It could also be some generational trauma and something that we may not even be aware of. And these struggles usually show in love and other relationships. So I can help them with anxiety, depression, and then continue on deeper work to help them in relationships.
And then Dalila, you also have a special gift for our audience, and it's a book about anger. I was hoping you could talk about that and also why anger is key to all of this.
Well, anger is an interesting, it's a secondary emotion, they call it. Anger is very special because that's one of the emotions that women often struggle with because it's not socially acceptable for women to show anger. But anger is a great entry point for us to be able to go inside and be in touch with our emotions. If we accept that anger, if we own it, and it's an emotion that shows us that something is not right, something is that we need to address something. So this book can allow you to do this process on your own and access these deeper emotions and kind of learn to observe your emotions a little bit.
Dalila, thank you so much for sharing your expertise and these wonderful insights with our audience. I know that this is going to be so helpful to women who are really just wanting to find that true, intimate, connected relationship and are just feeling, you know, a lot of struggle around it.
I hope so. And I really, really appreciated this opportunity, Lourdes. I enjoyed our conversation. And I hope our audience will too.
Take care. Thank you, Dalila.
Thank you, Lourdes.
Thanks so much for listening to the Women in Depth podcast. I hope it brings you a deeper understanding of yourself and others, and that you found some insights that illuminated and inspired. You can follow Women in Depth on Facebook and YouTube. And if you haven't yet, please subscribe on iTunes and leave a review. And finally, if you enjoy Women in Depth, please share with a friend. Again, thank you so much for listening and see you next time.